Thank you, Antonios. Thank you to the organizer for the invitation. I'm sorry for not being able to be more proactive in the last week because we were much involved in field activity. So during the summer, field activity, which are still ongoing in Italy, are keeping us very busy. So at the moment, I am in holiday in northern Greece, Antonios, in the Zagoria mountain, and I hope the connection still works because I am in a small hotel. So it's a pleasure to talk about history because at my age, unfortunately, the history started to be quite long, and it was nice to have the possibility to go back to the beginning of the SIT story, which is effectively more than 20 years now, but let's say 20 years to be polite. So many things happened during these 20 years. When we started, I remember I was quite alone in this adventure. And we started effectively because we soon realized that it was a difficult task to manage the Zygopictus invasive species with the usual tools, and also because we were taught by our professor in biological control and entomology, which is Giorgio Celi, which is died 10 years ago, about the possibility to use radiation, to use tools to sterilize insects, mainly in agricultural field, but also not only in the agricultural field. So I remember this because this was the beginning. So then the story was much supported by the International Atomic Energy Agency. We are now in the second turn of being a collaborating center as Centro Agricoltura Ambiente of the Atomic Agency, which support us very much and let's say guide us indicating the road because mainly of the experience out of the mosquito control field, which is mainly conducted against several agricultural pest insects around the world. It was a surprise to me to see that in Europe we have only one center doing SIT at the operational level, not against mosquito yet, but against Ceratitis capitata, which is in Valencia, Spain. We hope to build something more in the next few years. So we have a lot of support, of course, from European projects, from our region. We have an important collaboration, as you heard about CAPS, many municipalities. So we were able to keep the story running for such a long time. So why we start this against Aedes albopictus? As I say, is an invasive species. We have no satisfactory result with larval control, community participation, adult control. So we realized that we were not able to manage the situation in our town with the tool we have available, so we need new tool. The nice thing for albopictus is this, it is mainly related to the urban situation, so it does not distribution which is in agricultural or in natural area. So this is a kind of an island distribution, not 100%, but close to 100%. It is not a very vagile species. The females disperse few hundred meters, especially in the urban area. The male, unfortunately, spread low, less than females. And also, we still have a temperate climate, at least in northern central Italy, where we have still 6 months of population development and 6 months of overwintering in the egg phase. This piece is not so easy to read at the end of the story, but let's say it's easier than Anopheles, maybe. And also, of course, as Francis was mentioning before, we have the problem of vector disease, and we have the experience of the chikungunya outbreak in 2007 in the summer in our region, Emilia-Romagna region, which was a signal that something was going on, and this was maybe a good advertisement to the political decision maker to invest in new tools. So we start to rear a little bit the colony, and we start to use radiation. I cannot see here the, because it's closing my, let's say. In collaboration with the ENEA facility in La Casaccia, Rome, with Maurizio Calviti and the former director of the unit, they have a plant using cobalt 60 radiation that they mainly was using in the 70-80 for developing a new strain of crops. And we try to adapt the system to our situation, which is a strange situation because we need to radiate pupae in the water. And we build, let's say, artisanal plexiglass device in order to arrange 20,000 pupae per session. And this was done in the beginning from 2001, 2005, in order to understand mainly the biological reaction on the radiation and to understand the dose and the dose sterility, of course, curve. So you see here, at that time, we were using higher dose of radiation in comparison with what become the most, say, standard dose, which is now 35, 40 degree. So we use 80, 100, 110 gray. And you see, we saw the percentage of X at the time we used to call the X collapsed X because they were not able to develop. And the correlation between collapsed X and mosquito larvae, you see that percentage of larvae was not always in good relationship with the dose because other factors were playing a role at that time. We are not able to understand why, for example, we have releasing activities, fertile activity, residual fertile activity with dose higher than 80, but it was more complicated than previously. Understand. So also the male longevity was an issue. We need to understand the impact of the radiation, the somatic impact of the radiation on the quality of the male. So the quality of the male means the mating capacity, the dispersal, the longevity as well. So different factor produce the capacity of the male to mate with the females, and we see, for example, that the longevity of the male was strongly affected by increasing radiation in comparison with the control. And also we were able, luckily, because we had a collaboration with the municipality of Desenzano and the public health unit in Desenzano, which was one of the first town colonized by the species beginning of the new millennium. In 2003, we were able to irradiate the male at the Enea Casaccia using 80 gray and run directly with the car during the night to Enea and back during the day, and release the pooper, the male pooper. At the time, we were releasing male pooper in a container, on the ground in the bushes, and we have different experience by releasing a small number of males. You see, this was in 2003 in July. We released 8,000, 10,000, 20,000, 20,000, and the residual presence of females was between 1 and 3%. And this was the number of male per hectare, because this was a tentative to eliminate the population, which was still restricted in a very, very few hectares, but we failed, of course. But we were able to see that we had a good impact on the hatching rate of the eggs. You see, from 80-90 at the beginning to 7-15-50, so variability due to the low number of males, but we have an impact on the egg hatching, which at the time we use for, still will use for evaluating the induced sterility in the field. And also we have an impact on the reduction in the number of eggs in comparison with the non-treated area. From 2005, we were able to move to another irradiation system, which was set at the Sant'Anna Hospital in Ferrara, which is less than 100 kilometers from our facility, which is something that helped us to reduce the time, transportation, etc. And this is a machine that they use in the hospital for treating blood unit and different other blood components using cesium-137. Using the same gamma ray, but it's simple and let's say smaller to be managed. So we still work on this. We did work on several years of work on understanding the relationship between the dose. You see here, we have start to use dose below 60 gray, 55, etc., and to see the relationship between the dose and the residual fertility. Residual fertility can be something complicated, so it's still not well described and defined which is the best residual fertility to be accepted in big program, in big SIT program, because conventionally, we use 1% residual fertility as accepted, but scientific evidence to support why 1% is good and not 2% or 1.5 or 0.5% need to be, I think this is an area where we need to work more. And this was also a relationship with we start to understand between the age of the pupae. So the pupae in edible pictures last about, depending from the temperature, of course, but last about 48 hours, maybe a little bit more. And because inside the pupae, of course, so there is the metamorphosis, the sperm are in different stage of production, and this is largely affecting the answer to the radiation in the male sterility. So we realize that it is better to avoid radiate pupae younger than 24 hours in order to have maximal efficiency in the treatment. And also the effect of radiation in the pupal age depend or influence also the male longevity. We did also many studies. I am running a little bit in order to to skip from, but this was also work done to see the mating capacity. So how the radiation impacts the mating capacity. So we used to put one male with a certain number of females in the virgin female, of course, in the cage, to see how many females the male was able to. And then we have no difference between male radiated with 30, 40 gray with the control, but using 50 gray, we see that mating capacity was strongly affected. Then we moved to the, from 2006, we moved to the semi-field, field enclosure. We use this simple system that they use in agriculture for growing tomato, pepper, etc., which is largely available locally. So we put mosquito net and also mosquito shadow. And inside this enclosure, we can play different number of sterile male against fertile males and combination with virgin females. So we did a lot of work. We did some publication on this. We realized, for example, one thing that complicate our understanding of the phenomenon, which is the fact that radiation stimulate for a strange phenomenon, the speed of the development. So if you are not taking care of this, you may have bias in the result, because the irradiated males develop much faster than the non-irradiated males. So this can be a problem when you analyze the data. But we were happy. We were happy to see that in this number of replication, you consider we did a lot of work on this in 3 years, three summer. Replication took at least 1 month, so we were able to compare 30 gray against 40 gray and against control. This is the number of enclosure. We use 100 males sterile, 100 fertile, 100 females, so 1 to 1 to 1. And this is the number of eggs per female in the cage. By counting the females that bite the person, so we this is a system that a person has to be, a volunteer has to be inside in order to be bitten by the females. The way with the artificial blood system, you cannot fit this in this large. And you see here the hatching rate that we have in the control, which is about 86% in this case, against the hatching rate in 30 and 40 gray. And we have a nice index. This is a CIS is a capacity to induce sterility, which is slightly different by the historical use freed index, but it's not so important. So we see that using 30 gray, we have freed index about 1, which is the meaning that our males are exactly competitive as the wild male in this system. So this system is not really representing reality, of course. Reality is much complicated, but it represents something. We realize that it is not sensitive enough, in our opinion, to check the quality of the sterile male you are producing, because it is difficult to be standardized, and you need a lot of replication, a lot of effort to collect good data. So we are a bit still a bit confused on this. The question of recovery of fertility, the question was if the old males after 1 week or 10 days recover fertility from radiation because they are producing new sperm. So there is in effect a recovery in fertility that we observe in the field enclosure, but is a recovery of fertility, which is something that we consider to be not so important. Why? Because mortality in the field, unfortunately for our stalemate, is very high, especially during the summer months. So very few males achieve 7 days of longevity. So mostly of them, they die in 3, 4, 5 days. So the recovery infertility, in our opinion at least, does not play an important role in the final efficacy of the system. So here some data about the evolution from 2005 to 2009. You see the number of release, then the dose of radiation which was reduced in the time, the residual females about 1%, which is considered acceptable. The main productivity with the system that we have is very low. This is still one of the main factor that has to be improved, because in order to separate to sex the male from the females, we need to reduce the productivity, and so the cost of production is still very high. Mortality, number of sterile male hectare per week, which is another important parameter we are now a bit clear idea about the number to release in order to achieve a certain result, number of weeks per season, distance between release station. We keep the distance between release station about 100 meters, considering the dispersal study that we did, and the fertility reduction and the density reduction. So two main parameters are used, of course, to evaluate the efficacy in the field: the hatching rate. So we collect the eggs with the ovitraps and we hatch with the protocol into the lab, and the reduction in the egg density, of course. So these are also numbers of study that we did in the past. I don't want to pass much time on this. This is the old system of releasing and producing, in producing eggs in cages on the left and the larval tray on the right. We work on the correlation between the number of eggs and the larval density. It is important in the mass breeding to use homogeneous larval density, standardized larval density, in order to have a synchronous production of pupae. So you need to have a system to hatch the eggs and to consider all the week from the egg immersion to the water to the pupal collection, in order to keep the condition as much standard as possible. So we did the dispersal study, as I mentioned before. Here it was nice, this, because we used two methods for recollecting. This is a classical mark release recapture study in three urban area. And we use as a recapture system netting in the swarm. So the male in Albopictus swarm close to the ground in small, numerous swarming. So it is possible for a skilled entomologist to see this swarm and to collect them by net, the old entomological net still used, or using human landing collection with an aspirator, with a battery operated aspirator, and collecting the male and the female that come to the person. So it was nice to see that we didn't see big difference between the two recollection systems. So meaning that our males were able to swarm and to swarm together with the wild males. And also it is important to conduct this mass release capture study because you can estimate the survival rate. In this case, we compare two systems also of marking with flower with fluorescent powder FP or with Wolbachia. This was done in collaboration with Enea. So this strain they have that also I see the there will be a presentation in this meeting. So it is possible to use Wolbachia as a marker using PCR. Of course, you have to check one by one the individual to see if they are the reared one or the wild one. So the survival rate is very low, as I say, and this is much depending from the weather and the relative humidity condition. So during the July, August, in the Mediterranean area, the survival is close to 0.5, 0.6, which means that every day we have a mortality close to 50%. So that means that it is important to release, it is necessary to release maize more than once per week, and also other parameters that it is possible. So we did a lot of work, of course, in checking the maize quality and understanding the system. Then we moved to the, together with the atomic agent, we moved to new tools in order to increase the capacity to produce. The capacity to produce sterile maize is the most important thing at the moment. We need to be able to produce good maize with the very low cost. And so the cost is the critical element. The cost is still too high in order to become operationally at the level that is necessary for the municipality to be able to adopt this method in order to reduce the cost of production. Automation is necessary in order to reduce the cost of manpower and the number of people working on into the system. So I say something about this equation, which took a lot of work to understand. In our situation, at least, we have a good relationship between egg sterility and then egg density decrease in the range between, let's say, 30 to 70%. So we think that if you achieve 30-40% of sterility, you don't see any impact on the egg density. And we think that this is due mainly to the, let's say, density dependent factor playing a role in the field. And then when you go up, the impact is not really aligned. So this is quite not represent, this line, this does not represent the reality. When you go close to 100% of the elimination, the relationship is still changing. So it will be, next time we will be able to show a curve, not a line in this relationship. This was the system that we used to for several years to release the sterile male pupae in the water in the field. So using this plastic container with the sponge with oil, the sponge was plenty of sugar solution. So the males during emergence, they stop for a while, few hours, taking the sugar and fly away. And the system was not bad in our opinion, at least for the quality of the male. You see here some males, but the problem of ants was something important. And also in terms of operational, we abandoned this system because we think it is too much time consuming in the management, and it cannot be something that is deployed on large scale, but the idea was not bad. So at the moment we are developing a prototype for mass reading, a prototype which is less than 100 square meter, is able to produce 7.5 million larvae per week and able to produce 1 million males approximately, depending from our skill, our capacity. So this is the bench of testing the automation, and we hope to be able to build a new one in a short time in order to be able to increase the capacity of sterile meat. We are testing this machine from Wolbachi company in China, which is working on the glass system, the old glasses, the Faye Moreland system, but it's automatic, so it's able to reduce the cost of manpower. So we also think, I say, different projects, the atomic and the infrared too. For example, we have the capacity and with the support to do field trial in Greece together with Antonios. We were able to do work in Germany together with CAPS, etc. So thanks to the support of InfraVec 1 and InfraVec 2, which are Horizon, European Horizon project. Norbert already presented some results about this, so I will skip from this. We are now much involved in Bologna, our main town. This year we are able to cover an area of 100 hectares, combining one turn of door-to-door at the beginning of the season with SIT. So our integrated system package could be just one turn of door-to-door at the beginning to inform and to reduce the number of breeding sites in private area and release biweekly. So we have planning. We are planning and conducting two releases per week with a total number between 2,000 and 3,000 sterile male per week and using 30 of ITRAP to check the situation. So our region is strongly involved in edible pictures control. So you may see information, useful information from a monitoring system, for example, which is running from 2008, more or less standardized in order to be able to collect data which are comparable. And what we are seeing in the system is that we have, despite a strong effort from the authority, municipality, and the local health unit, we don't see any evidence of reduction. So seems to be an increase, but this increase, if this increase is real or is an effect of different question, I cannot see. But we have an evidence that in any case, the integrated control system in place in the region, which is not SIT, of course, is the usual larva control, community participation, information, school, et cetera, is not working. It's not working. There is no sign of decreasing the population. So this is a confirmation that we need new tools in order to be able to manage the Aedes albopictus. Finally, I say something about the cost, which is the real problem that we have to consider. So with the current conventional control is costly about, in our region, €1 per inhabitant, okay? And we estimate that we have a reduction in the population of this system against nothing, versus nothing, is 30-40%. And we have a residual number of expert of ITRAP 14 days, which is the system we are using now, which is in the data that I presented before, between 400 to 600 X per orbitrar per 2 weeks. When we go for intensive door-to-door, which means 5, 6, 7 turn of intervention during the season to cover all the activity, very intensive, meaning that we put a threshold of at least 95% of private houses visited by operators, the cost becomes 6 to 8 euro per inhabitant per year. The reduction of population is close to 60-70%, no more. And so we have a residual number of X per habitat between 200 and 250. And currently with the seed package, SIT package, we estimate a cost of 9 to 10 euro per inhabitant per year. So it's most costly. And the population reduction, which is in this range, 80-90%, residual number of X per habitat per 2 weeks, 100-150. So this is the scheme that we may be able to reduce this cost and to increase this number in order to have better results. So many people were involved in all this activity during 20 years. So I didn't mention all of them because I'm sure that I was not able to forget all of them, but enthusiasm and motivation was the main component of this. Of course, we need the young people working on this, and many activity was supported by the institution that I was mentioning before. So I thank you for the attention and sorry for not being able to stay with you more time. And also I will have to move later on. So I will not be able to attend all the round table, but I will be happy to answer any question also by email eventually. Thank you.